Okay, Dr. Kimberly Vannest. So I don't even know about your background in terms of your undergraduate degree and your graduate degree. Where did you go to school?
I did my undergraduate degree at Cal State Chico in Northern California, actually. Really? Yeah, in business administration, of all things. In
business administration.
Mm-hmm.
And then how did you get here? How did you get to where you're at?
Well, I got a teaching credential to teach high school business. So I was a general education high school teacher and a girls' basketball coach, of all things.
The excitement about Texas
Go
A&M.
Aggies. Yeah, exactly.
Okay, that makes a lot of sense.
All right. So I taught general ed. I taught accounting and typing and computers and the business machines when you had the carbon copies, mimeographs, all of that back in the day.
All of this that I have never known start to make so much sense.
So, and I knew absolutely nothing about students with special needs other than they were in my, because I was basically considered a voc ed teacher. So everybody who needed an elective took typing or one of those types of classes. So I had a lot of students with special needs. I just hadn't been trained. It's a 1-year program, you know, as post back in California for secondary teachers. And I didn't know anything about that group of students. So when I went back to get my master's, I got my master's in special ed.
Oh, cool.
And that started me sort of on this path, and I was teaching in Big Bear, California, which was up in the mountains, and I moved back home to Escondido, which is in Southern California, and taught there, and the only job I could get was teaching special ed, teaching kids with behavior disorders, right?
I think a lot of people get into it that way.
That's right. So I was coaching girls basketball and teaching special education. So I'm the stereotype, I guess, for who they got to teach kids with BD. And I was in a little hallway closet outside the library.
Uh-huh.
And I had kids with autism and schizophrenia and then conduct type problems and severe learning disabilities and just everything all in between. But so I taught there and I taught severe disabilities in a mall, did voc training for kids with severe profound disabilities.
Mm-hmm.
And then I taught kids with more mild moderate disabilities in a comprehensive setting. So at one point I had 35 kids with disabilities in a classroom. So I ran my classroom. It was huge. It was bigger than general ed.
That is huge.
So I did an okay job. So it meant I got more kids.
Yes, exactly. So, and where'd you go for your doctorate?
I moved to Louisiana and went to LSU.
Okay.
And worked with Ken Denny and Tim Landrum.
Oh, yeah. With Tim Landrum.
Yeah. And Vollmer and Witt and Bullmeister.
Wow.
And Northrop. Those guys were all there.
Yeah.
At the time.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, that
so
was
they were all in psychology and I was in an education college. Special ed was in the education college. So.
And they were heavily involved in single subject work, weren't they?
They were, absolutely.
Yeah. So is that where you developed this interest in other methods of data analysis? How long has this been going on?
Well, this has been going on probably the last 7 years since I came to Texas A&M in terms of more analysis interest. When I went through my doctoral training program, it was primarily visual analysis, and Kasdan was the Bible. It was all about, you know, the only statistical analysis question was percent of overlap or if you got that far, or variance, how to handle bounce when it wasn't a perfectly straight line. And data for kids with EBD are just not always straight lines. There's a lot of bounce.
Absolutely.
So it was, when do you have variability and how much variability is it?
So, that was going to be one thing I was going to ask. So, if you had to tell my students why they should consider not doing just visual analysis, as some folks would tell them.
Right.
Even some people in my department who would tell them that.
Sure.
Why should they look at other methods than visual analysis for single subject?
Well, a couple reasons. The first being that statistical analysis tells you some things that visual analysis does not. One of those being, how big is the change?
Right, right.
So visual analysis and a good design can tell you if, maybe it can, if change happened. So if you have a flat line and a big flat line and an immediate change, you have the right design, you have a reversal or multiple baseline, you can infer a functional relationship, but you don't know how big that change is. And if you're trying to determine between two competing intervention practices, you have no idea because depending on your axes, you don't know which one's bigger or not or more meaningful.
So not only are we not going to be dealing with data making, level data making a specific right. change, but there's all kinds of crazy stuff going on, right?
Right. Yeah, so when you have all that overlap and variability and you're in a practical setting like a school or a clinic or a home, that you don't have control over all the environmental factors. And mm-hmm. when you don't have control over everything, the kids in the class, the teacher, the substitute, the fire alarm, the pep assemblies, or whatever else is going, dad comes home, goes away, you have bounce in behavior. And the ability to use a statistical procedure can tone down that noise and handle that in a way that visually we can't as humans. We just make too many errors in that type of decision making.
Huh.
So partially because we're not blind to the intervention or the, we cheer for our own data.
That's another, we were just talking about a lot of the crazy effects that go into single subject, and that's absolutely another one of them.
Right. So if it's on the edge and it means something to me to say it worked, it's really hard to say, I'm not sure that worked. But the numbers lie differently or lie less, right? So it's a little harder to fudge that say, and it's okay too to say, you know, the effect size was 0.2, so that's small, but it may be very meaningful for the kids you worked with that it was a small change. Sometimes a small change is a huge difference in a school setting, mm-hmm. but good to know, especially if you have to defend it to a parent or, heaven forbid, court, yeah. Good to know the size of those changes.
Yeah.
So, and improvement over time.
So you're talking more about this on an individual basis. I guess I'm used to hearing about effect size as a tool for meta-analysis across, kind of synthesizing across large numbers of studies. Have you done the same thing with this across multiple single subject studies?
Yes, we have. And we've been able to then combine all of these single case designs to determine what an overall effect size is when you sort of throw them all in the hopper, if you compare all these A's and B's and maintain the integrity of the design, what that will get for you. You can also, using effect size, parcel out what moderators helped you get those effects. So you can determine, for example, whether age makes a difference in using a self-monitoring treatment. Is it really more effective with older kids, or does it really not make a difference? And in that case, I think the answer is it doesn't really make a difference. It works really well for little kids and older kids.
Huh.
For a daily behavior report card, for example, you can determine that, or we determined in a recent study that if the parents are doing home contingencies, you get much greater effects than if you don't. But you still get good effects if you do it without that. So you can, that's when you say, which one are the essential ingredients, which is really something that's kind of near and dear to my heart, that you can change the soup. You know, you can add chicken or take out celery,
yeah.
But there are some pieces that if you don't have them in there, it doesn't work. And the rest of it's sort of fluff.
And all that kind of analysis just isn't possible if all you're doing is visual analysis.
That's correct.
So you're missing that. That's, wow. So you're making a strong argument here But yep. So the students.
Practical settings. Yeah. Practical settings is one real big issue. Yeah. Size of effect is another real big issue. Cumulative effects is another one. So we've got kids who are really resistant to treatment, and we have 3 or 4 or 5 days of baseline data, and we try intervention for a few days, and nothing happens, or not a whole lot happens, or it's real unclear. And many people will say, abandon the study, or it didn't work because you didn't have immediate intercept gap, you didn't have, large and compelling change. But what about the cumulative effect in over time? If it's a learning issue, if it's a skills deficit and not a performance deficit, the kid might need time to really sort of internalize that skill or master that skill and be able to apply it in ways that you can see. So it may just take, some kids are just going to be more resistant. Mm-hmm. So if you give up without giving them sufficient, 8, 9, 10 data points to check, there might be an accumulative effect size that's going on that you miss.
Wow. So students are going to read this article about the 9 different methods.
Yep, that's a good.
That you sent along. Yeah, well, I was looking through that. It is a good one. It gets more complicated as you roll along. It starts out simple.
Right.
So for people that are going to be new to doing single subject, what do you suggest to them in terms of choosing a tool or an analysis method when they're doing some of their initial work?
Right. Well, the improvement rate difference method is one I like because it's a hand calculation and it's pretty simple. You eliminate the data points that overlap on either side and you give points for ties and you do a quick add subtract and you can come up with a score that is it's basically an odds ratio from the medical literature, and it's very easy to interpret because it's a percent of change difference.
Oh, so it's similar to odds ratio.
Yes, that's where we stole it from.
Okay. Well, that makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
Well, actually, I'm going to have to cut this short.
All right.
I really appreciate you being with us and talking to us about this.
It's nice to talk to y'all, and good luck in class.